One of our favourite cars here at Pikes Peak International Hill Climb 2018 is the Sendy Club's Wolf GB08, owned and driven by Robin Shute. The Wolf GB08 chassis is purpose designed as an endurance car, and in stock trim it uses a Mugen built Honda K20 engine that's mid-mounted. While the naturally aspirated K20 is competitive for circuit racing and endurance work, it wasn't going to cut it here for Pikes Peak. So the Sendy Club have been busy over the last few months, ground up rebuilding the car and making a huge number of modifications purposely so they can be competitive here at Pikes Peak. The team really haven't had a dream start here to Pikes Peak, with the first day of practice on Tuesday morning encountering a misfire with the engine. It's taken them the entire week to diagnose. However, a lot of hard work, a lot of hours put in, and not a lot of sleep resulted in a second fastest in unlimited class on Friday for the optional practice day, showing that the car and the driver really have what it takes. So with the modifications needed to be competitive at Pikes Peak, this started with the engine. A Honda K20 has been retained, however this time the engine is supplied by Honda Performance Development. It's now at just under 2.1 litres, thanks to a set of ductile iron sleeves and a slightly larger bore diameter. The engine is fitted with a set of aftermarket forged pistons with a 9.5 to 1 compression ratio, as well as aftermarket forged steel conrods for reliability. The cylinder head is CNC ported, and it's also fitted with a set of aftermarket drag cartel cams. Now, in this instance, due to the way the engine operates over a relatively narrow rev range, once it leaves the start line, the VTEC mechanism has actually been locked out, so it only runs on the high lobe cam the entire time. It does, however, retain the adjustable or variable cam control on the inlet cam. This allows the cam timing on that inlet cam to be advanced or retarded around about 50 degrees while the engine is operating. This allows the cam timing to be optimized to suit the specific engine operating range, be it RPM as well as engine load. The result of this is a wider torque band, which makes the engine more usable. Boost pressure is supplied with one of Garrett's G-series turbos, specifically the G25660 with a 0.92 AR exhaust housing. Now, using boost here at the high altitude of Pikes Peak does allow the team to claw back some of the power that's lost due to the low air density. And specifically, the team can also increase the boost pressure as the car runs up the mountain to maintain a relatively consistent power level. Now, it's really critical when doing this that the turbo speed is monitored. As we go higher in altitude and the air pressure drops, in order to maintain a consistent boost pressure in the inlet manifold, this requires the turbocharger to be driven harder and harder, working at a higher pressure ratio. This results in the turbo speed increasing. It's really important to monitor that turbo speed to make sure that the critical speed of the turbocharger is not exceeded. In this case, via the ECU, the turbo speed is monitored and capped at 162,000 RPM. If the speed is exceeded, the boost control will actually reduce the boost pressure. The aim of the boost control is to maintain a consistent 16 psi in the inlet manifold all the way from the start line to the finish at 14,000 feet. Now, if they can maintain this consistent 16 psi, it should result in a relatively consistent engine power. This does, however, require the turbocharger to be worked harder as the altitude increases, and this results in an increase in turbo speed as well as exhaust gas back pressure. Boost control itself is managed by a Tial 44mm external wastegate, and the electronic control comes from the MoTeC ECU, which we'll talk about shortly. After leaving the turbocharger, compressed air runs through a rear-mounted intercooler, and this also uses an air scoop to ensure that air is driven through the core. And this is really one of the problems with running at such high altitude, as well as the engine suffering from a lack of oxygen to make power. The cooling systems on the car also suffer from a lack of air density passing through those coolers. This reduces the efficiency, and we find that cars here at Pikes Peak do really struggle with temperature control, both in the air temperature department as well as engine coolant and oil temperature. After exiting the intercooler, the air then travels forward in the car to the Skunk 2 inlet manifold. It's been fitted with a drive-by-wire throttle body. There's a few advantages with going to that drive-by-wire throttle body, specifically when it comes to the gear shift. Now, in terms of that transmission, the car's fitted with a rear-mounted Sadev 6-speed transaxle, and this is paddle shifted through the MoTeC ECU. The reason that drive-by-wire throttle body is so important to the setup is that it allows the ECU to perform a throttle blip on the downshift to match revs. And this just ensures that Robin can remain in complete control of the car, he can left foot brake, he doesn't need to use the clutch, and he doesn't need to heel and toe on the downshift. It also means that he can keep both hands on the wheel for the paddle shift system. The engine runs on VP Racing's Q16 race fuel, which is delivered via a set of four Injector Dynamics ID1050X injectors. The ID1050X injectors are well suited to use on the Q16 race fuel due to their full stainless construction. Q16 racing fuel does contain an additive called MTBE, which does play havoc with some other types of injectors, affecting their flow and long-term reliability. Power-wise, the engine's producing around about 460 wheel horsepower as measured on a Mustang dyno. However, we do need to factor in that the engine was dynoed in Denver, which is at about 6,000 feet, so this will affect the power level. If we consider the power at sea level at the flywheel, it's likely to be somewhere north of 550 horsepower. And when we also consider that the chassis only weighs 550 kgs, it's fair to say it's got a pretty impressive power to weight ratio. The electronics package starts with a MoTeC M150 ECU, which is running MoTeC's GPRP package. This stands for General Purpose Race Paddle Shift. The ECU controls every aspect of the engine's operation, including the fuel delivery, the ignition timing, the variable inlet cam control, the drive-by-wire throttle control, as well as motorsport functions such as anti-lag and launch control. Of course, there's also the boost control strategy that we've already talked about, where the boost can be mapped versus engine RPM, throttle position, as well as barometric air pressure. A MoTeC C127 dash logger rounds out the electronics package, providing a driver display as well as a central logging location. The car also houses a PDM or power distribution module, which allows the team to get rid of any fuses and relays, and all of the switching of the different electronic circuits for every aspect of the car is controlled using solid state relays. This ensures reliability and gives a lot more flexibility in the fusing of the different circuits, as well as the ability to retry any circuits out on the racetrack or course while the engine is actually running. Power to weight is obviously a key metric for any competitive hill climb car, but of course, we can't overlook grip as well. In this case, when going from the endurance racing spec that the Wolf originally ran in, the team have upgraded the wheel and tyre package, fitting larger tyres. In this case, the original rear wheel and tyre package has now been moved to the front, and a larger wheel and tyre package has been fitted to the rear. This has also required the original endurance spec bodywork to be cut away to provide clearance for those wheels and tyres. Along with the larger tyres, a lot of work has also gone into the aero package. This has actually been developed using CFD, although at this point the package has not been validated in the real world. A lot of development here has gone into both the front and rear wing designs. In particular, the rear wing has benefited from a second element, the aim there to obviously improve downforce while hopefully not producing too much additional drag. Unfortunately, with the problems that the team struck early in practice, this meant that they weren't able to qualify. This means that they're actually going to be forced to run off the back of the field, and here at Pikes Peak, weather is a real concern. Often we end up with hail or snow coming across the top of the mountain later in the afternoon. Despite this, the car is definitely competitive. There's no doubt that Robin can drive it, and we look forward to seeing how the team go, and we hope that they get a clear run with good weather.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson. You'll learn about performance engine building and EFI tuning, and you'll also have the chance to ask questions, which I'll be answering live. Remember, it's 100% free, so follow the link to claim your spot.